Now, there's something I want you to notice in the context this morning of these baptisms. How many options are there in terms of the response to this stone? Two options. What are those options?
To accept Christ.
To accept Christ or? Is there a middle option?
No.
So it's one or the other. Which means that all of you this morning who are here listening and those subsequently listening to this on the internet, all of you are in one or other of those two positions. You either have accepted Christ, you are someone who is being lifted by God, you're accepting the salvation that's offered in Jesus, being born into our world, dying on a cross so that we can be reconciled to God. You're either in that category, or you are rejecting God's offer of salvation.
This is GBC Web TV, on the internet at gbcweb.tv. Welcome to Greenford Baptist Church in West London. Here you can watch inspired biblical teaching and find out how to apply God's Word to your everyday lives. On the website, you can also listen to audio versions of these programs or download them as podcasts. Today's program is called Listening to God, Luke chapter 2, verse 21 to 40, by Pastor David Wise.
Over the last 2 weeks, we've been looking firstly at the birth of John, and last time we looked at the birth of Jesus as described by Luke. And this morning we're going to continue by looking at some events that took place about a month after Jesus was born. But let's cast our mind back to last Sunday. Who was here last Sunday? That's about four of us. Yeah, that's not very impressive. Come on, a bit more honesty. Who was here last Sunday? Oh, that's slightly more. That's because you know what's going to come next, isn't it? Absolutely right. What were the key things? As we worked through the passage last Sunday, we looked at the birth of Jesus. We went up to verse 20 of Luke chapter 2, so we're picking up from that this morning. What were the key things that we took away, that we learnt last week? What were the key lessons from last Sunday? Hola.
God uses ordinary people to do extraordinary.
God uses ordinary people to do extraordinary things. We're going to see some more of that this morning. That's very good. What else? Joan?
Following from that, God's assessment of people's status is very different from ours.
Yes, because we saw God using people that were actually banned from giving evidence in court because they were seen as so unreliable because they were just shepherds. And we saw how God chose them, the only people he chose to be his witnesses. So his estimation of people is very different to our estimation. What else from last week? When we looked at the responses to the birth last week, do you remember we spent a bit of time looking at three responses to Jesus' birth from people? Yeah? What do we learn from that?
We learned that the shepherds, though they heard the word when the angels came to meet them, and they immediately obeyed what the angels told them to do.
Okay, we saw that it was the shepherds that actually did what God asked. And we saw about the fact that actually being amazed at the events of Jesus is not enough. Being amazed is not enough. You actually need to do God's word. And it was the shepherds that did that. And we saw that last week. That remind a few of you about that? A few nods. I know about half of you weren't here last week, so that's okay. Now, what I want you to grasp this morning, we're going to look at two other incidents this morning. And the thing that about them that I want you to get hold of is the way that God can transform an ordinary, mundane, everyday event into something very, very special because someone is listening to God. I mean, most of you in your life, what you'll be doing tomorrow, assuming you're back tomorrow in your usual routine, will be the sort of things that you do most work days, most Mondays. Yeah, you'll get on the same bus, the same train, go to work. Some of you will go to college. Some of you will be at home. Kids may not have started back school yet, so maybe you've got to think of Tuesday. But you go through the same pattern, yeah, day after day. And so your expectation is that tomorrow is going to be just like it was last time. And sometimes in those situations, we have our ears closed to God because we know just what's going to happen. So we don't need to bother listening to God, we think. But there are occasions when God wants to transform the mundane, the ordinary, into something extraordinary. And for that to happen, we need to be listening to God. I've told the story before, so apologies if you heard this story before. In the church that I look back on as my home church, many years ago, we had a couple of quite wild teenagers converted, became part of the youth group. And they were, they were pretty wild. I mean, they during worship, they would do forward rolls down the aisle because, you know, just to celebrate God. I mean, this is 35 years ago, and that sort of thing wasn't done, but they did that because they were so excited about God. And one day, these couple of lads in the morning, they felt God speak to them. They'd only been Christians about a month. And they felt God tell them to get on a bus and go to Guildford. So what do? They got on a bus and went to Guildford. So they arrive at Guildford bus station, and they felt God say to them, go and talk to that person over there, pointed an individual out to them. And God gave them something very specific to say to this person. Now, I don't remember the details. But they went and they talked to this person. And this person had been actually asking God. They weren't a Christian, but they'd been in desperation asking God a question. And these two guys travelled all the way from Farnborough in Hampshire to Guildford in Surrey to meet this person at this bus station and just to bring the answer to the question that this guy was asking. You see, the ordinary being transformed by listening to God. And that can happen so often for us in life. Through the different things that are happening, we need to be listening to God. Just one other story. One of my leaders at the church I was at before here, if you don't go to pubs, you'll have to excuse the story. He's in a pub, and it's quite late, and it's a pub he always goes to. Always has a drink there, and he doesn't have a drink problem, you know, just goes as a drink. And God says to him, go and talk to that person at the bar, and gave them a specific thing to say, which was outrageous. So he went over, and he said this outrageous statement to this guy, who started crying. And they were talking until 4:30 in the morning. You see, he's just the ordinary, transformed by listening to God. So I want you to watch for that as we look at this story, as we work through this morning. And I want you to take it into your own life as well. So, let's start first of all with Jesus' presentation. Luke chapter 2, verse 21. If you've not found it in one of our church Bibles, it's on page 1028. On the eighth day, when it was time to circumcise him, he was named Jesus, the name the angel had given him before he had been conceived. And when the time of their purification according to the law of Moses had been completed, Joseph and Mary took him to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord, as it is written in the law of the Lord. Every firstborn male is to be consecrated to the Lord, and to offer a sacrifice in keeping with what is said in the law of the Lord, a pair of doves or two young pigeons. What is happening here is that Mary and Joseph are obediently following what was required of them by the law. This is referred to back in Leviticus. You don't need to turn to it unless you want to. I'm going to read it to you. It's Leviticus chapter 12, where this is laid down. Leviticus 12, verses 1 to 8. The Lord said to Moses, "Say to the Israelites, a woman who becomes pregnant, gives birth to a son, will be ceremonially unclean for 7 days, just as she is unclean during her monthly period. On the 8th day, the boy is to be circumcised. Then the woman must wait 33 days to be purified from her bleeding. She must not touch anything sacred or go to the sanctuary until the days of her purification are over. She gives birth to a daughter. For 2 weeks, the woman will be unclean as during her period. Then she must wait 60 days to be purified from her bleeding. When the days of her purification for a son or daughter are over, she is to bring to the priest at the entrance to the tent of meeting a year-old lamb for a burnt offering and a young pigeon or a dove for a sin offering. He shall offer them before the Lord to make atonement for her, and then she will be ceremonially clean from her flow of blood. These are the regulations for the woman who gives birth to a boy or a girl. If she cannot afford a lamb, she is to bring 2 doves or 2 young pigeons, one for a burnt offering, the other for a sin offering. In this way, the priest will make atonement for her, and she will be clean." It's just notice that, just in passing, that the offering that was made here was the offering for a poor person. It just underlines what we were looking at last time about Jesus being born into a very poor family. And they couldn't afford the standard offering. They had to make the offering that was allowed for people who were poor. Now, normally on the 40th day, a firstborn son, as we've read, was redeemed. And was redeemed also by payment of 5 shekels to a priest. If you don't follow the detail of this, it doesn't matter. I'll come back to it another way in just a moment. Now, this payment of 5 shekels, this redemption, went back to the Passover. Do you remember we looked at that in the teaching on Exodus? When during the night, the firstborn sons of all the Egyptians were killed by God. In God's sight, all the Israelites deserved death. But God was willing to accept from the Levites their lifelong service to the tabernacle, later temple, and from all the other tribes, the symbolic payment of 5 shekels. Now, why this is interesting here is that what took place with Jesus was different. The normal thing was this redemption, but it didn't normally take place in the temple, and there's no reference to the redemption payment here. And so what is happening with Jesus here is not redemption, because he was sinless. He did not need to be redeemed. He, in fact, was going to die on the cross for the redemption of others. What is happening here is an echo of 1 Samuel, and is not the redemption of Jesus, but the consecration of Jesus to serve God. And some of you will know the story from 1 Samuel chapter 1. And let me read it to you from 1 Samuel chapter 1 and verse 11. And then I'm going to read from verse 21 to 28. 1 Samuel chapter 1 verse 11. And the context here is Hannah, who is wanting a child. She has not had a child. She made a vow to God, to saying, "If you will only look upon your servant's misery and remember me and not forget your servant, but give her a son, I will give him to the Lord all the days of his life." And her prayer was answered, and she gave birth to a son, and she kept her word. Verse 21. "After the boy was weaned," this is actually verse 22, "I will take him and present him before the Lord, and he will live there always." So verse 24, "After he was weaned, she took the boy with her, young as he was, along with a three-year-old bull, an ephah of flour, a skin of wine, and brought him to the house of the Lord at Shiloh. When they'd slaughtered the bull, they brought the boy to Eli and said to him, "As surely as you live, my Lord, I'm the woman who stood here praying to the Lord. I prayed for the child, and the Lord has granted me what I asked of him. So now I give him to the Lord. For his whole life, he should be given over to the Lord." And what we're seeing here is an echo of that. And the theological point is that Jesus was sinless, so didn't need to be redeemed, and he was consecrated to the Lord. So you can read more of that in detail later if you want to. Let's go on to the first of these two stories that we're going to look at this morning. Verse 25. Now there was a man in Jerusalem called Simeon, and he was righteous and devout. He was waiting for the consolation of Israel. I'll explain that in a moment. And the Holy Spirit was upon him. It had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not die before he'd seen the Lord's Christ. Now, Simeon wasn't a priest. He wasn't a Levite. He was an ordinary member of the public who had given his life over to serving God. And on Simeon, the Holy Spirit rested. Now, remember, this is before Pentecost. The Holy Spirit had not yet been poured out. That's still to come. So for the Holy Spirit to rest on somebody before Pentecost was actually very, very rare. And he's waiting for the consolation of Israel. At this time, Israel was an occupied territory. It was occupied by the Romans, and it was ruled by a very cruel king. And the consolation, it's a phrase that was used at the time, referred to the fact that the Jews expected God to intervene in history, into Israel's situation, to bring the Messiah or the Christ. And he was waiting for the Messiah to come, waiting for the Christ to come. And the Holy Spirit had said to him, "Before you die, Simeon, you will see the Christ." Now, let's begin to use our imaginations for a moment. If you're a visitor here, just to explain, as we're working through the scripture together, we spend some time thinking about things together, and I sometimes ask some questions. So let's think about Simeon. All we know about Simeon is what I've told you so far. Ordinary member of the public, giving his life over to serving God, waiting for the consolation of Israel. Holy Spirit was on him, and he was told he was going to see the Christ. Can you just imagine? Let's just use our imagination. Imagine that you're Simeon. We don't know how old he was. So it could have been exactly your age. Just imagine that you were him. Just imagine what life, what his thoughts were, what his feelings were, what life was like for him. What do you think? What do you imagine as he lived this life? What do you think life was like for him? There's no right or wrong answer to this question, so it's a safe one to answer. But let's try and imagine that we were Simeon. Yeah, Jane.
Assuming he was telling people that this was going to happen.
Yeah.
I'm just thinking, who's that strange man who just keeps waiting and waiting?
Okay, so people might have thought he was a bit odd because his life's given over just to wait for the Messiah, who he believes is coming. So people probably thought, that's Simeon. You know, Simeon, he's waiting for the Messiah. So maybe there was some of that around. Yeah? What else do you think? Yeah, Denzel.
I think there might be times when he was kind of almost looking at everybody and wondering if this was it. You know, maybe he saw a man or a soldier, or, I mean, because he wouldn't know what the Messiah was going to look like.
No.
So he'd have all sorts of fantasies and ideas and wondering, you know, is this it? Because it's going to
happen. So maybe he's standing there in the temple or walking around Jerusalem and he all the time he's looking, is this the person? Is that the person? That looks a likely person over there.
Yeah.
And is that the one God?
Yeah.
So all the time, yeah.
But I suspect if it was me, then there'd be times when it kind of, because it didn't happen, I'd kind of forget it for a while.
Yeah, you'd stop looking and forget.
Then remember and start.
That's what I'm looking for, yeah. Because you after days after, we don't know how long he'd been waiting. He might have been waiting years and years and years and years. And he might have got a bit fed up. You know, oh no, not another person. Yeah, okay. What else? What else? Yeah.
People probably will have been saying to himself, it's great expectation that he will see the Messiah before he is dead. And you're probably not anxious, but sort of just can't comprehend what it's going to be like when he actually
sees. Okay, so there's an expectation in him that something is going to happen. He's going to see the Messiah before he dies. So all the time there is that expectation. Yeah? Joan?
Even if it was a very vague idea of what it was going to be like, he'd have been wanting to live his life in a way that made him ready.
Yes, so all the time he wants to be, because, you know, meeting the Messiah, and he doesn't know that it was going to be a baby. He's probably expecting, because the idea of the Messiah coming was of the Jews had got it slightly the wrong idea. They're expecting a warrior figure to come. So he'd want to be, make sure he was absolutely ready. So living his life in a holy way and ready. Anything else? Carol?
I think he would have been very attentive at the temple and there quite a lot.
Very attentive. Very attentive. So he'd be there a lot looking.
Yeah.
Looking, yeah. Okay. Did I see someone here? Yes.
After some time, I think that doubt would also happen in his mind after a long wait.
Okay, so maybe some doubt there. Have I misheard God? Have I got it wrong? Are these people that think I'm a nutcase right? So maybe there's some of that around. Okay, so let's pick up the story, verse 27. Moved by the Spirit, he went into the temple courts. When the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him what the custom of the law required, Simeon took him in his arms and praised God, saying, Sovereign Lord, as you have promised, you now dismiss your servant in peace, for my eyes have seen your salvation, of which you have prepared in the sight of all people, a light of revelation to the Gentiles and for the glory to your people Israel. Here's the thing. Simeon was guided by the Spirit to be in the right place at the right time. This was the moment. This was the moment, in fact, he was living for. But all the time he was listening. And God said, Spirit prompted him, go to the courts of the temple. And he's there, and God, the Spirit, points out to him, it's that baby. Now, I don't think from what I've read of the expectations of people at the time that he would have been looking for a baby. The idea that was common among the Jewish people is they were expecting, as I said, a warrior figure to come crashing into history, to lead the Jews in rebellion against the Romans, in armed uprising and armed conflict. That's what they're looking for. That's what they're expecting. So this would have been a bit odd. But you see, he's listening to the Holy Spirit. And the Spirit says, it's that baby. And so he goes and he takes the baby in his arms and he prophesies over the baby, full of echoes, his words here from Isaiah, stressing the fact that this is part of God's long-term plan. And the amazing thing, I mean, we just take it for granted here, because most, if not all of us here, who are in the building, this part of the building at this point in time, are Gentiles, are not Jews. And we take it for granted that salvation is for us. But it wasn't taken for granted before. You may remember that it was a struggle for the church, the early church, to accept the fact that people who weren't Jews became Christians. But here is Simeon saying, a light for revelation to the Gentiles. Wow. What a statement. The child's father and mother marveled at what was said about him. Then Simeon blessed them and said to Mary, his mother, "This child is destined to cause the falling and rising of many in Israel, and to be a sign that will be spoken against, so that the thoughts of many hearts will be revealed, and a sword will pierce your own soul too." The falling and rising of many. Anybody know what that image is about? You may know where it comes from, but it's an Old Testament image. Do you know what it's about, Carol?
Stumble.
It's connected to that, yes, and we're going to come to the cornerstone in a moment, but the image is actually has a different link. First of all, we come to the cornerstone after. Does anybody know what the image is about? An image that it's going to be the falling or rising of many. We know where that comes, what the image is. Yeah,
I don't know. I'm just
guessing. Have a good guess, go for it, Joe.
But clearly people either rejected Christ or accepted him. And so all of these Pharisaical leaders rejecting Christ were falling, but they didn't realise it.
Yeah.
But the ones who accepted him, like Peter the fisherman, was raised up to be, you know, part of the church.
Yeah.
So that's what I wondered if it meant.
Yeah, it means that. Do you know what the physical image is? The image is of a walkway through, perhaps through a valley where the very high sides and a stone, a huge rock, has fallen down, and it's there in the path. And so when you come to that, there are two options. You rise over it, or you fall trying. So it either is a cause of stumbling, because you can't get past it, or a cause of you rising as you go over it. That's the background to the image, and it's there in the Old Testament. It's something that God puts in the way, and you are either exalted or humbled depending on your response to it, and on your response in this context to God's salvation. And as Joe said, it is this stone, which is the stone the builders rejected, which we'll come to in a moment, but this stone that actually reveals the states of people's hearts. Either they're exalted or humbled, depending on their response to God's salvation. And it links into the passage that I spoke about on New Year's Eve, 1 Peter chapter 2. And verse 6. For in Scripture it says, "See, I lay a stone in Zion, a chosen and precious cornerstone, and the one who trusts in him will never be put to shame. Now to you who believe, this stone is precious. But to those who do not believe, the stone the builders rejected has become the capstone, and a stone that causes men to stumble, and a rock that makes them fall. They stumble because they disobey the message, which is also what they were destined for." Now, there's something I want you to notice in the context this morning of these baptisms. How many options are there in terms of the response to this stone? Two options. What are those options?
To accept Christ.
To accept Christ, or? Is there a middle option? So it's one or the other. Which means that all of you this morning who are here listening and those subsequently listening to this on the internet, all of you are in one or other of those two positions. You either have accepted Christ, you are someone who is being lifted by God, you're accepting the salvation that's offered in Jesus, being born into our world, dying on a cross so that we can be reconciled to God. You're either in that category, or you are rejecting God's offer of salvation. You're in one position or the other. I'm not, you know, passing judgment on you. I'm not pointing to you and saying you're in this or that. But it's clear that it's one or the other. There is no middle place. It's not, well, I'm undecided. Well, if you're undecided, you have
rejected
at that point in time. For those that reject, there always is the option of accepting. So if you, this morning, you think about yourself and you're in the category where you have, at this point in time, not accepted and therefore have rejected the message of salvation, forgiveness of the things that you've done wrong, reconciliation with God, which includes being baptized, by the way. If you're in the category that you've never accepted that, this is your opportunity today. Today is the day for you. But until you come to that place, as you heard Henry and Joshua talk about, for Henry, it was a very clear moment. There was a particular moment in time when he decided to turn to God. For Joshua, it was a period of time. There was a point when he didn't know God at all. There was a point when he was committed to God. And there was a process in his life. But you have to move from one to the other. And if you've not moved from one to the other, you are still in a situation where you are separated from God, not knowing salvation, not knowing forgiveness from sins, and going to an eternity that is separated from God. And the challenge is there. It's one or the other, depending on our response to Jesus. Simeon also, as he was talking to Mary, he saw that how some would respond to Jesus would cause great pain to Mary. You know, Mary, like any mother, must have had huge hopes and expectations for her son. And yet, the pain of watching him be rejected and crucified was dreadful for her. A sword, said Simeon, will pierce your own soul too. Let's move on to Anna. There was a prophetess, Anna, the daughter of Phanuel of the tribe of Asher. She was very old. She lived with her husband 7 years after her marriage, and then she was a widow until she was 84. She never left the temple, but worshipped night and day, fasting and praying. Coming up to them at that very moment, she gave thanks to God and spoke about the child to all who were looking forward to the redemption of Jerusalem. Anna's age, the way that it's described here is in the Greek, is a little ambiguous. She might have been 84. She might actually have been 105. The reason she might have been 105 is that she would have got married at the age of 14, because that was the usual age you got married. She was married for 7 years, which makes you 21. And she was a widow for 84 years, so she could have been 105. The Greek text you can take either way. So she's either 84 or she's 105. You can take your choice. But in those days, even 84 was very old. 105 was very old. So imagine for a moment, Anna. Let's think about Anna and about her life. What she thought, what she felt. What do you think? What do you think of Anna? What do you imagine life was like for her?
Lonely.
Why do you think lonely?
No husband.
No husband. No child.
Just going about doing her own thing every day. Going to one to
her. So she's just living in the temple, praying, fasting. So lonely, isolated. Yeah, okay. Jo.
I only just had a question. Like, would she have been in the temple out of choice or because no one was there to support her?
Well, she would have been in the temple out of choice, but you're right that also she didn't have, because there was no pension, there was no benefits, so she would have been dependent upon people giving her. And she had normally, you know, your husband would support you after your husband died, your children supported you, and she didn't have any. So she would have been there out of choice, but she also would have been dependent on the almsgiving of others. So, yeah. Anything else about her? Joan, you're looking extremely thoughtful.
She might have been considered a bit of a nuisance.
Considered a bit of a nuisance? Why do you think a nuisance?
Well, the officials of the temple would have liked everything to be tidy and sorted. And there was this little old lady batting around and maybe getting in the way sometimes.
Okay, all right. So maybe the temple authorities thought that she was a bit of a nuisance because she was there all the time, never went home. You described it, batty old lady flitting around, maybe not in the right place, doing quite the right thing as far as they were concerned. Yeah? Jane?
I'm just wondering, did she know Simeon? Did they talk about the coming Messiah together?
Did she know Simeon? That's an interesting question. That, the phrase redemption of Israel and the consolation of Israel are equivalent. They both mean exactly the same. So she's waiting for the same thing. It's likely she would have met him in the temple because she was there all the time and he was there a lot of the time. So, maybe, maybe. Any other thoughts? Any other observations? She had the Holy Spirit too. Yeah. Again, as I said before, very, very rare. Was that Leslie's hand I saw over there? It was, yeah.
I think she would have been knackered.
Knackered?
Knackered.
Okay.
Very tired. Because, I mean, at that age, you know, always constantly praying. I'm tired just walking down to Greenford, you know. I am, seriously.
Okay, so...
I think it would be quite tiring on an 84-year-old.
Okay, so tired.
Yeah.
Tired person. Okay, yeah. Anything else? Yeah, right at the back. I'll come to you in a moment, Fiona. Yeah.
I think she was in the right place at the right time because it says here that at that instant she came in. Yeah. She could have been anywhere.
She was listening to God, wasn't she? Because the temple wasn't a small place. So she was in the right place at the right time because she was listening to God. Did I see someone else's hand over here? Oh, Fiona, of course, yes.
Simeon was quite generally just tolerated by possibly the church leadership. He was generally regarded as possibly as rebellious, I'd say. Anna, because she's a woman, she'd be even worse than him. And
yeah.
They'd be trying to think of hundreds of ways to get her out of the church because she's just...
Yes, yeah, so the temple leadership would not have liked her because she was a woman and women... Now, the Orthodox Jew in those days, in their prayer, would actually pray every day, I thank you that I'm not a Gentile, and I thank you that I'm not a woman.
Yeah, exactly. So she would not...
It's true. It's true. They prayed that part of the praying every day. So there was this, yes, so she was someone who would have been looked down on. Lastly, Denzel.
I think she might, because she's so old and unusual, wondering why on earth God was keeping her alive for such a long time.
Yeah. Yeah, maybe. Why am I here after all this time? I know I said you were last, but Liz?
Just the fact that she's described as a prophet. She was obviously actively engaged in speaking out what God was saying.
Yeah. She's described as a prophet, which means that she must have been prophesying around the place. And again, because having the Holy Spirit in those days was rare, and prophets were even rarer. So the fact she's described as a prophet means that she would have been listening to God and speaking out. So like Simeon, She's in the right place at the right time, listening to God, and then the mundane. She's been doing this for 84 years. Same routine, day after day. And suddenly, there have been other moments when God's spoken to her, but this is transformational. She spoke about the child to all who were looking forward. This wasn't a private word just for Mary and Joseph. She spoke to everyone who was looking forward to the redemption or consolation of Jerusalem. When Joseph and Mary had done everything required by the law of the Lord, they returned to Galilee, to their own town of Nazareth, and the child grew and became strong. He was filled with wisdom, and the grace of God was upon him. Again, in these two verses here, there is this link back, this reflection back into Samuel's childhood. But here also is the fact that Jesus grew up with parents who honoured God. They were God-fearing, God-honouring parents. Part of the mystery, of course, of what we call the incarnation, the fact of God being born as a human being, is Jesus growing as a child. You know, we jump into the story when he's 30. He begins his ministry, he's 30 years old. But for the previous 30 years, before that, he'd been living and growing. And living and growing as a normal child. Well, normal, except that he didn't sin. And if you've had children, you would know that's a little unusual. But he grew as a normal child. So, in the last few minutes that we've got this morning, let's think about from these stories what we can learn about ourselves. Now, we're not going to go and stand in a temple waiting for the consolation or redemption of Israel or Jerusalem. But what do we learn about ourselves as we begin 2009, this first Sunday today? What are the things that we take away from this passage this morning into this year with us? What are the key things? I see a hand right at the back. I don't know who the hand is attached to, but I do see Hannah. Yeah.
What should we do if we listen to God? Because it's the big more than that. God would want us to do certain things for him. And also for ourselves, so we should be attentive every point in time. Okay.
And it's Fumi, not Hannah, now I got here. So it's listening to God and being attentive to God as we start this year, listening to what God wants for us for this year. Fiona.
God honors his promises, maybe not the time scale that we'd like, but he does honor them. So if he's promised you something.
So God keeps his promises. It might take a bit longer than we would want, but he always keeps his promises. Yeah, Michael.
We should always be in a state of readiness.
We should always be in a state of readiness. So as we come into 2009, we should always be in a state of readiness for serving God. Yes, very much so. Very good. What else? Joan.
We should be in the sense that Simeon and Anna were waiting for the coming of the Messiah. We should be waiting and preparing for the second coming.
Absolutely. The Bible's very clear. That we as Christians should be living in expectation of Jesus' return. And that should affect the way that we live all the time, in the way that it affected the way they lived as they waited for Jesus to come. I've asked you the question before. Some of you weren't here. We're not going to go into detail with this now. But I remember asking a question. If you knew that Jesus was coming back at 2 o'clock on Tuesday afternoon, how would your life be different between now and then? We haven't got time to do the full exercise. But here's the rub. if there are anything that's going to be different, it shouldn't be so. Because you should be living your life in expectation of Jesus' return. So, I wouldn't do that tomorrow is not a good answer. You see the point here? So they were waiting for the consolation of Israel. That was their focus. We're looking at, on our horizon, is the return of Jesus. And we're living for that. Yes, what else? Jo?
Why is slight tangent, but if we have the Holy Spirit with us, we're like Jesus, and we're his representatives, then we're also like a stone in the way to other people.
Okay. I like that. So it's a sense that we, because, I mean, the word Christian means literally little Christ. So we are like little stones. So people's have the opportunity to respond to Christ in us. Yeah, very good. Timmy.
Salvation is for everybody.
Salvation is for everybody. Everybody. No exception. All people. Very good. Yes.
That you're never too old, basically, because obviously she was being 80-something.
Yeah.
So you're never too old.
You're never too old for God to work in your life.
And that women and men are equal.
Women and men are equal. Yes, absolutely. They're both equally made in the image of God. In fact, you could... I've got a moment for a slight aside. You could argue... This is slightly tongue-in-cheek now, but you could argue that women are actually the pinnacle of creation. And you can argue, I'm sorry, Timmy, this is... Timmy's having a little trouble here. When you look in Genesis at the order of creation, you know, there is a going up the order, and what's finally created is women. So you might want to have a think about that. Subject for debate on another day. But God uses equally men and women. They are equally made in his image. And that's a very, very good point. Anything else? Yeah.
You're with him or you're not.
That's it. You're with him or you're not. You know, it's as clear as that. Yeah.
Obedient to his word by being a stepping stone and not a stumbling.
I like that. We need to be obedient to his word by being a stepping stone and not a stumbling block.
You can either accept or reject Christ, but there's also a chance of accepting for those who reject him.
Okay, we can either accept or reject Christ, and if we have rejected him before, there still is the opportunity for accepting, even this morning. Okay, let me just draw these things together. Three things that seem to be key to me. Now, we need to allow ourselves, and I want to challenge you this year, this week, as you come into this year, to allow yourselves to be guided by the Holy Spirit. Wherever you are, whatever you're doing, because as God takes hold of you, as God's Spirit fills you, as God's Spirit works through you, even the most ordinary, mundane situations can be transformed by the power of God. Amen? We want to see that, don't we? Whether you're at work, whether you're at home, whether you're with family, whether you're in the supermarket, whether you're at the school gate, be listening to God all the time, listening to God, expecting God to break in. And if you have to wait a few years, still keep listening to God. I don't think you will have to wait a few years because the Holy Spirit is really active in this season. And God wants to use you in all sorts of places and ways. You're never too old to serve God. And there are only two options in our response to Jesus. I want to pray for you. Let's stand together. And I want to pray for God to use you in this week. Let's make it specific. Father God, we thank you for Simeon and for Anna. We thank you for their example. That they were obedient to you, ordinary people like us, prompted by your Spirit. Father, thank you. Thank you that the same Spirit that was in Simeon, the same Spirit that was in Anna, is in all of us who trust you. All of us who've made a response to you. Your spirit is in us. And Father God, I want to ask right now, lift out your hands before you, Father God, I want to ask now for everyone here this morning, for your spirit to freshly fill them as we start 2009. For a fresh endowment of your spirit, a fresh filling of your spirit, a fresh anointing of your spirit on every individual who is here in this room now. Father God, for your spirit to be poured out. Father, we want to see your spirit working through us. We give you permission to use us this week, wherever we are, when we're at work, when we're at home, when we're at the school gate, when we're in the supermarket, wherever we are, we ask you to work through us. Father God, give us listening ears that we can hear your spirit speaking into our lives, into our situations, that we can bring your word to people around us, that we can see the ordinary, the everyday transformed and changed by your spirit's activity in us and through us. Father God, we recognize that we are in a world of need. We're in a world surrounded by people that don't know you, people who are in pain, people who are lost, people who are in darkness. And as they come into this year, many people who are fearful. Father God, help us to bring good news. Work through us. Use us. May we be the place where heaven touches earth for those around us this week. Father God, may your spirit fill us, your spirit work through us, changing and transforming in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Please sit down.
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching and other videos at gbcweb.tv. And before you go, an invitation especially for you. Why not visit us at Greenford Baptist Church on the corner of Beechwood Avenue and Ruislip Road in Greenford, West London, the United Kingdom. Our phone number is 020 8575 5034 and our TV website is gbcweb.tv. We look forward to seeing you soon.